Like if a woman owned anything, when you look at the ancient laws, it belonged to her husband. If she got a divorce, the children and everything had to go to the male. This system switched everything around. Like, but if she got a divorce, her clothes, everything had to go back to her husband. Because a woman's considered to be property of her husband. That's a maxim of law. What's your country, nationality?
American
national, someone been enlightening her. But pretty much, you see what we got standing? We got all so-called black people. And that's how they, everybody can sit down. That's how they view you. Like, so if you anytime you identify yourself as Negro, black, colored, you see what Martin Luther King was doing? Fighting for civil rights? You still don't have a nation. Because, like, if I could say I'm, if you ask the average so-called white person, I say so-called, there's no such thing as a white person, right? That's a social political status. There's no such thing as a black person. And the people that's in power, they know that. So, but when you identify as black, like if he say he's from like Mexico, right? Then, okay, the Mexicans, you're gonna identify with a flag. Or if he say he's from German, you can sit down. Because his nationality would be what? A German, right? But if you say you're black, what's your nationality? What country are you from? You can't say you're an American. Because, that's not an American. What's your nationality? They just using the term like American loosely, right? But if you tell them to go deeper, people start to say, well, yeah, I'm Irish. From Ireland, right? Nationality, okay? If you say I'm Dutch, that's a nationality. But when you talk to a black person and you try and trace them back, well, because my point is, well, every nationality, there's a land involved. You see what I'm saying? And there's a flag involved. So you can trace those people back to a land, like a landmass. But when you deal with blacks, you'll say African American. That's not a nationality, that's a country and it's a continent. So if they try and go to Africa, they can say, you don't belong here, you're not African. But they call them African Americans, you see what I'm saying? So can't be both. You can't be an African and an American, so you don't have any nationality. So this is where I tell people you gotta claim nationality. You see what I'm saying? So the proper nationality would be an American national, right? Yeah, American national. Go ahead. But this takes that away. So when people, and I find it really funny, when people come here from like Trinidad, Jamaica and all that, first thing they want to do, claim citizenship. You see what I'm saying? And so before they claim citizenship, they literally have more power. Because they're not obligated to pay taxes or anything like that. I'm not a citizen. You see what I'm saying? So what you should say, well, I'm indigenous to this land. You see what I'm saying? I'm an American national, so on and so forth. But then they're looking at you from a whole different perspective. But if you just say I'm a citizen, they're not even talking about citizen in one of the states. Because before the state went under the jurisdiction of the United States, it was good to say you're a state citizen. But once they fell under the jurisdiction of Washington, D.C., they became a franchisee of Washington, D.C., so you're still a corporate fiction. You see what I'm saying? Go ahead.
In 1860, the 14th Amendment, which created a new class of citizen, all men and women are created equal, as stated in the Declaration of Independence, as a sovereign king.
The Declaration of Independence, everyone's identified as a sovereign, as a king. What is a king? A king is the authority. Where does every government get their people from? In the Declaration of Independence, it says that, you know, all form of governments is from the consent of the governed. That means we the people. So the government gets its authority from us. So when a judge is in public office, and if I go in as a man, I have authority over the judge. Because I'm going in as a man, and he's a public servant. That's why it says on the side of police cars, to serve and to protect. But it don't really mean that. Because now the government has become a 5,000 pound gorilla. And now the people fear the government. But not realizing that we the people gives the government its power. And also in the Declaration of Independence, it say, well, if the government becomes unruly, you are to abolish, and replace that government. The people don't think, I'm scared, that's the government. You better do something, that's the IRS. Good?
Became a person or a fiction, a subject in the federal government.
So you're subject in the federal government. It's not even, you know, the original United States, which is actually talking about all, you know, the states, you know, because these states was actually really an individual nation. Like that document I have on my website, Corporate Federalism, it goes into that. It explains that to you. How your state, your country was a state that you was born in. until they came and screwed it up. Go ahead.
In 1871, the federal government formed itself into a corporation.
Is that not in 28 U.S.C. 3002, subsection 15A? The government is a federal corporation and not a country. Go ahead.
And pulled itself from under the Constitution.
So now they're not operating under the Constitution. So after this, guess what? This is why when you go into the courts, the judge said, you mentioned Constitution in my court one more time, I'm going to find you in contempt. Because right here, in 1871, they started operating under contracts. Maritime Admiralty Law, which is the law of the sea. Go ahead.
In 1913, the Federal Reserve central banks were created.
Before this, they was dealing with greenbacks. They were dealing with gold and silver. Right here, they created the Federal Reserve, which is a private offshore company. It's not even federal. They just use it. The Federal Reserve Bank is about as much federal as a Federal Express. You see what I'm saying? Mm-hmm. Not federal at all. Mm-hmm. Same thing. They just use the name federal. Just like Washington, D.C. is as much of the United States as Canada is. It's not. It's not part of the United States. In fact, the politicians that work in Washington, D.C., they don't fall under any of the laws that they charge you with. It's a whole separate city. It doesn't fall under the 50 states. That's why when you read certain things, it says the United States and any of the several states. It makes a distinction because Washington, D.C. don't fall under that. Go ahead.
In 1933, President F.D. Roosevelt put into effect the Trading with the Enemies Act. This applied only for federal citizens.
Remember, Will Smith made a movie, Enemy of the State? So they're talking about put the truth right before you. Ah, it's just a movie.
Making you enemies of the state. Number five, in 1933, President Roosevelt took the gold away.
This is why they accepted for value. It's valid right here. This is why the 1099 OID is valid, right there. When he took away our ability to pay, right there. They did it. I mean, it's on documented record. Go ahead.
They snatched the gold from the people, although they were not required for giving it away, thereby leaving the people without money for paying debts with.
So if they took money away, how can we pay anything? Because Congress was actually never given the authority to print money. It was given the authority to coin money. So it's gold and silver coins.
I was trying to write all this, but I can't keep up. Is this in one of your books?
It is.
Absolutely.
And it's on the DVDs.
No,
you can put it in the books, man. Because then everyone's going to start taking it.
So they did
it. Now you're trying to travel across the burning sands, man. You got to go through initiation, man. You got to ride that donkey, man. See what I'm saying?
So they did away with justice.
Yeah. It's just us. It became a just us system. All right, go ahead, Cam.
Books and DVDs on the table to the right.
This is in the books, man. And the DVDs. No recording, man. You're a violation of the contract. Escort that man out of here. Throw him in the box.
Finish
him. Finish him. Look, Lorraine State shaking his head.
Damn, man. Tyler's not wild, man.
Number six, March 9th, 1933.
Hey, Lorraine State got it. That's your mentor right there. I mean, he got it. He got everything.
Yeah.
So he got the last seminar, man. He got all of this. All you gotta do is correspond with him. You good. Okay.
March 9th, 1933, Senate document number 43, 73rd Congress, first session states the ownership of all properties in the state, individual so-called ownership,
Joe was talking about right there,
is only by virtue of the government, i.e. law amounting to mere user, and use must be in accordance with the law and subordinate to the necessities of the state. Seven, in 1933, President Roosevelt passed H.J.R. 192, June 5th, 1933. Simply put, since the government had taken the gold, the people had no money to pay. And the government would pay the debts for the people.
And it literally states this in House Joint Resolution. Somebody has a copy of it. It literally states that there.
Yeah.
They would pay every debt dollar for dollar.
It's clearly.
Thereby,
it's a remedy. It's a remedy.
Thereby, giving the people unlimited credit. Number eight. 1938, Erie Railroad versus Tompkins made contracts the rule in our court.
This is why you hear me saying so many videos, contract is law and law is contract. If there's no contract, there's no case, because of this right here, this court case right here, it made all contracts the law of the land. So anytime you go into the court, there has to be a contract involved. That's, sign a ticket, there's a contract involved. But we're here, you signed that driver's license. So you agree to everything in the driver motor vehicle manual. So there's a contract involved. You know, even with a job. So you fill out the job application. A question.
Is that one of the courts that operating off of laws, that operating off of policy?
What was that?
Is that one of the courts that operating off of policy as opposed to law?
No, or for contracts. Yeah, public policy, yeah.
Yeah, just like you said, when you get in that Uber, you know what I'm saying, you create the contract. So when a judge asks you something to tell you to do something, you create a contract as well.
Yeah. But I mean, you gotta be like a computer scientist to understand
that's right,
that.
That's right.
Machine code. Yeah, man. Hey, you gotta do a PIPA, man. You gotta be able to ping that IP address.
A phrase worth repeating: if there's no contract, there is no case. Number 9, in 1946, we lost our government in courts through the Administrative Procedures Act.
So you can do a lot of administrative procedures. And I've done this where it's a cab company trying to sue me in New York. They ran into my car, but, you know, me and the cab driver, first of all, I'm stopped on Fifth Avenue, like right in the back of Mount Sinai in front of Central Park. And this guy comes by driving ferociously. And he smashes my mirror. I'm driving a Lexus, mirror just knocked off. Then he drives up about two blocks, let the passengers in his car out, and then he back up. So, oh, no problem. My cab company, he worked for the Yellow Cab in New York. Those are some of the worst drivers there is. Yeah, just let's exchange information. So, you know, we exchange information. He's like, don't worry, my company will pay it in 2 weeks. I get a damn summons in the mail to go to court, said I hit this dude. Mm-hmm. So I didn't take no pictures. I'm serious, real talk. I didn't take no pictures. I did an administrative remedy, man. I made him go away. I did an administrative remedy. I reversed it and done a conditional acceptance on that. Go ahead.
And number 10, in 1965, the Civil War was taken away as means for paying debt. The UCC became the supreme law for American concerning the banking system. The courts were pulled together in administrative admiralty and civil contract or commerce corporation, and the act and intent were brought together, thereby taking away our plea. What happened here?
Let me get in for a second.
Let's skip the hard things. Technical difficulties.
That's why you're a computer scientist.
Yeah, just jumps to it.
No, that's, the act. And intent was brought together, thereby taking away your plea of innocence. Guilty until proven innocent. Changing the author quoted, you are innocent until proven guilty.
That's crazy, man.
Start me right there, because I'm about to skip over this bank receptor.
Okay. You have to become educated to protect yourself, your family, and your business. As it is said in court, ignorance of the law is no excuse. Remember that statement is a two-way street. How many of the, that's like 60 million, laws don't you know? The government will use your ignorance against you. To educate yourself there, visit our YouTube channels, Deprogram Enlightenment.
Okay, so we're going to get to something.
Oh, yeah, you should already know all three.
All right, so we're going to start with Dave. So, that's the question. We're going to go to the next slide in a second. But Greece, cool Greece, man. What does it mean to? I think we might have overheard that. What does it mean to suffer? So let me ask you this. Let me put it in this scenario. Let's say you got pulled over by two police, right? And they told you to driver's license, registration, and insurance. And you'd be like, yo, man, why you pull me over? I need to know why you pull me over. You roll your window down halfway, and let's say, roll this damn window down now, you freaking spook. Or we're gonna take you out. And you don't roll the window, they break it out. You seen some of those YouTube videos, they break people's windows out, and they snatch you from the car. They start beating you with a nightstick. So, I mean, they beat you up pretty badly. And you go to court, and the judge, asks you, did you resist? Or did you suffer at the hands of these police officers? That, you know, you claim attack you. Which one would you say you did?
I was attacked.
No. If he asked you, did you resist? Because the officer's more than likely gonna say, you resisted a police officer. The judge will say, well, did you resist these police officers? Like, they're certain, or did you suffer at the hands of these police officers that you're saying that beat you with a nightstick?
Right.
So did you suffer at their hands?
Oh, yeah.
My next slide. Say that question. Next slide. I read that.
I would like to point out, let me jump to suffer.
No, go to NA.
Okay. I would like to point out when you see NA in law, it does not mean non-applicable. It means
so most people think that means non-applicable. It means non-assumptive. In law. Go ahead.
A subset, an action for expectation damages based on the breach of an express promise or contract to pay a debt. Non-assumption is a defendant's claim in form of a pleading that he or she did not promise or undertake any obligation as alleged in a complaint.
So, Risa, he would suffer at the police officers because they beat him. Look what suffer means in law. Pay attention to it. Look what it means if he said he suffered. If the judge asked him, did he suffer? Read that.
What is suffer? To suffer an act to be done by a person who can prevent it.
So that means he could have prevented the ass whippings that the cops gave him, but he suffered, right?
Is to permit or consent.
So that means if he said he suffered, that means he permitted the ass whipping. Go ahead. Now this is how the language of law works. I'm showing you how ridiculous it is. Go ahead.
To approve of it.
So that means he approved it. Beat my ass. This is what you're saying when you say you suffer. You see what I'm saying? Wow. You see how this system works?
Yeah. This ass whipping is approved by your name here, and not to hinder it.
That means you could have hindered it, but you didn't. Go ahead.
But isn't that like an older definition of suffer too? Because I feel like I've heard it, you know, can you suffer me a meal? Can you suffer?
Yeah, it is. Yeah. So using different language. But this is the legal definition.
Right.
This is legal, so this is how they play it. So this is legalese. So, now I know if I'm talking to him, that's like, yo man, this chick made me suffer. He already know what I mean. I mean literally what I'm saying to him, just talking in common parlance. But my point is when you're in a court, when you're talking legally, the words don't carry the same meaning. And so, we've been taught to speak in common parlance in school, from school up. And I see how they teach us to walk in a single file and all that. All of that is programming you for a system. So the same way they program us with words. So they tell us to use words like this, like suffer, then we go to court, we get jammed up. Yeah, I suffered at his hands.
And there's like three cases there, four cases.
Yeah, there's case law right here, where it was used right there. Yeah, there's case law where it was used in court. Yeah, I suffered, I agreed to it. Next slide.
I agree to it.
Yeah, you ever thought?
The biggest program that we run into with the masses is a sheer disbelief of their own power and who they truly are. A masterful job has been done to get humanity to this level of spiritual weakness and incomplete ignorance. This was the intent of corrupting the ancient truths, rewriting our past, and presenting this in schools, churches, and all levels of eco-academia. Repeat a lie often enough and you will believe it. It is far easier selling a giant lie to the masses than selling us one by one. The media is the main tool of thought, direction and manipulation to reinforce the lies we were filled with as children and up to our current state. We have many soulless entities on this planet, with the vast majority being placed in positions of power and control, be it police, courts, media, churches, government, schools, military, and all at all levels. Fear is their only tool, and once one sees one's own true immortal nature, one becomes untouchable, literally. The massive...
because your fear prevents you from thinking clearly. But on the other side of the fear, if you could overcome the fear, you got to keep in mind, fear is an intangible that you create within your own mind. The only reason that you fear going into court, because you're imagining all of these bad things that's going to happen to you. And guess what? As the scripture says, a man thinketh in his heart, meaning your mind, so is he. You're gonna carry out certain actions on a subconscious level that will that into existence. That's what fear does to you.
I had a quick question. What about when you get pulled over by police? If I was under duress, that's what I was
going to
ask you.
Yeah, that means you was kind of like under stress. You was forced to do it, right?
Yeah.
That means you wouldn't do it willingly. So you was under pressure. So I was like, I done so in the protest. I mean, I didn't agree with it and duress. Like I was coerced, basically. Okay.
The massive.
So that makes it illegitimate, right? I could bring an argument from that because I did so under duress. That means it's not a valid contract. I didn't willingly agree to it. Okay.
The massive gnosis of humanity is deep, and you will meet all the levels of this resistance from friends, family, co-workers, etc. So don't bother trying to wake those consenting to be dead. The facts
you gotta wake them up, like you were saying, let the dead bury the dead.
The facts to prove this. Get them.
It's my favorites.
The facts to prove this are all there for us to see, so it's up to them to look, not you. Simply put, the seed, plant the seed and walk away.
So that's what you do. Shake the dust. You tell them they don't want to hear it. Shalom. Have a nice day.
You can't look back.
They are the same as the ones in the allegory.
Don't be like Lot's wife.
That came into the ark too late.
Lot's wife.
Lot's wife.
Too late.
Turn the stone.
She looked back. She looked back at her heart towards Sodom and Gomorrah.
Oh, yeah. That one too. I know another one that turned the stone from the
them ground. We are now at the culmination of destroying these entities once and for all, and they are pulling out all the fear, porn, illusion, and desperation plugs, and in that process, they're sinking their own ship. Where I merely hand them
you gotta be a computer scientist to understand this for real.
I know.
But you know, real talk.
Yeah.
Okay.
You and only you can save yourself and no one else, so stop killing yourself.
See, only you can save yourself.
Let the dead bury the dead, and perhaps they will get it on the next pass, but they are not your concern. Stay the course. The path home is one of the truth only and nothing else. Your willingness to stand in truth is yours alone, and to the degree that you stand will be the same degree that you become untouchable spiritually and as a result physically. As above, so below, after all.
Oh, that's one of the famous sayings of the people that crossed the burning sands. As above, as below. Albert Pike.
Yeah, I'm on that.
Apple pipe.
There is no middle ground here. You're either in or you're out of Babylon. You are either master or slave, mortal or immortal. The soul, you, are infinite, where the body is merely a biological computer you operate. Your computer was infiltrated and corrupted, the reptilian brainstem fused chromosomes, and separated from the heart source mind. The soulless ones cannot experience compassion, so don't expect them to. They are the same as the Terminator droids in the movies, programmed to control and kill without remorse and are easy to spot. They are everywhere, including your own family, friends, and all you have to do is feel your way through. Let your instincts and your heart be your guide. We are clearing this reality of these parasites exponentially now, where universal laws reign supreme, where none shall or can trespass. They are masters of deception, so do not let your loving compassion be used against you. Something that has been their most powerful tools. The bioborg entities are already lifeless and are dependent only on being able to suck the life out of you, but like every vampire, they cannot enter your reality without an invitation. Every use of the legal name is the only invitation they need, so best cut your ties and
legal name,
that.
You have to separate yourself from the name.
Just get this concept and you have already cut the puppet strings, and your casual ability returns instantly in relationship to your ability to be responsible with the ultimate of powers. To the walking dead, and you know who you are, your time is over. Your deceptions are powerless, and now, moment by moment, by now you are being erased from consciousness for the invading parasites you are. We of the living soul are awake, aware, and reclaiming our reality where yours never existed. In short, yes, you are doomed. Did you know that the courtroom operates by
Donald
massive
Trump
deception?
Got a short time to stand.
Donald Duck. Governmental agencies and judges routinely trick people into giving up their constitutional rights and binding them with policies and regulations instead of the law.
Yep.
Hmm.
Nah, we're going to skip that part. Let's keep it moving.
Trust.
We need to skip over this. This is too long.
Okay.
Next slide. Next slide. Next slide. Next slide. Okay. Next slide. Okay, right there.
Is public mass education really worth it? Higher learning. Ooh, buddy. The quality of education given to the lower caste must be of the poorest sort so that the moat of
this is strategically planned. This is where crimes in like urban areas are much more higher. They give you poor education, and so as a result of poor education, the crime rate always escalates. Okay.
Isolating the inferior class from the superior class and remains incomprehensible to the
Did you know that prisons
class.
Was actually built on by people that's actually unable to read by the level fourth grade? Like most black boys that can't read on the fourth grade reading level by fourth grade, they are like, there's a high percentage of like, I think it's like 80, 90% of those black boys end up in prison, one to two times by the time they're 21. So if you're in the fourth grade, and you're like on a second reading grade level, they are building prisons for you.
By formula.
They do that. It's strategically planned like that.
That's crazy.
Okay?
With such an initial handicap.
And so one of the first things they do, the school system said, well, little Ray Ray has a problem. We're going to recommend him for remedial reading. Then they put him in special ed. How many students you know went to special education never got out? None of them. Once they put a so-called little black boy in special education, he remains there. And so he either eventually drops out of school and he ends up in crime, some criminal situation. See what I'm saying? It's strategically planned. And so who do you have? 95%, I think it's like 80, maybe 75 to 80% of the people that's teaching little black boys in elementary school or so-called white women that's actually never had an interaction with a so-called little black boy. And strategically it's been planned that Europeans and blacks have a different form of like thinking and learning. Like Europeans have a tendency to do better on test exams because they think with a different section of their brain, right? So when a lot of so-called black boys, they're telling that they have, because girls by nature could sit longer periods than boys, right? Because the testosterone, right, that males have, and so so-called black men have more testosterone than any other man on the planet. So he's naturally more hyper. So it's more difficult for him to sit longer periods of time. You see what I'm saying? So when they try and teach a so-called black boy in a classroom setting for long periods, he can't sit there that long. So the teacher starts to interpret that as, oh, he's hyperactive. He has ADHD. And so they put him on Ritalin. And so the so-called black woman, she wants a damn check. She's not thinking, oh yeah. Put him on drugs so she can get a little check for him now. But now it messes him up for the rest of his life. Because those drugs, it creates a chemical imbalance in your brain. And so you get to a point where you need that drug to function. That's why when you see a lot of these psych people that go and shoot up the clubs in the schools, they generally do that when they stop taking that medication.
Because they're kids, bro.
Yeah.
You're messing with them kids' mind, dog.
Yep. They screwed up the mind.
I was in all that when I was a kid, and my parents were like, no, this is making it worse. And they made them take me off.
See that?
And Ritalin, all that.
See that?
Me and Clonidine, all that.
Yeah. Yeah. When I was working at Mount Sinai, I was walking around some of the patients, and some of the people, you know, lose little children, man, losing bladder control. When they came in, they was normal. Absolutely, this is like a normal kid, you know. But then you see him go back like 2 weeks later, because I repair the computers, like in the psych section. I go back, the kid's walking like a zombie, man. And some of them, they got violent. They would put him in like a 4-point restraint and throw him in a damn quiet room like an animal. You know what I mean? They got a little kid locked up in a quiet room and restraints like this, 4-point restraints, man. So of course, their minds get more violent and more violent.
Yeah.
It's like being institutionalized, man. Go ahead.
With such an initial handicap, even bright, lower-caste individuals have little essential to maintaining some measure of social order, peace, and tranquility for the ruling upper class. Human Commerce, when the governors made the pledge, they agreed to register the birth certificates of the people with the U.S. Department of Commerce. The birth certificate is a security instrument, collateral, used to back up the pledge. The legal fiction was created by using the name of the birth certificate and writing it in all capital letters. The designation for a legal fiction, then because of the pledge, you were determined to be the surety for the legal fiction. Surety means the one who is responsible to pay. So when the government or any corporation uses any process whatsoever, they're using it against the fiction and they want you to think is you. The living flesh and blood man cannot be a legal fiction. And a legal fiction cannot be living flesh and blood man. One is real or natural, the other is created by law and is a fiction. Whenever a government agency, such as a court, determines liability directed to or laid upon the legal fiction or the straw man, since everything is done in commerce with fiction's corporate entities, you are presumed as evidenced by the pledge of your governor to be the surety for the straw man, and you must pay the fine, fee, tax, debt, or any other liability. Remember, every transaction is presumed by the government to be a transaction in commerce by legal fiction. Presumption for straw man. The only way out of this is to overcome the presumption that you are the surety for the debtor of straw man, which is a legal fiction. That's why the redemption process is the only way to defeat this presumption by using the universal.
So they automatically presume everyone is the same thing, like a straw man, a legal fiction. They automatically presume that. So unless you send them the proper paperwork, putting them on notice that I'm not a legal fiction, I'm competent to speak for myself, then they're presuming that, hey, you're all the same. This is why if you go into a court, You'll see them go through cases like that. Boom. 2 minutes. Done. Next.
Uniform.
Until they get, no, yeah, seriously, yeah, it's right. Yeah. Then you get someone in there, and they call him, and, what's your name? They say, well, I'm here as intervener. And the judge will call the prosecutor over and say, well, you scheduled him for last. Or we're going to call a recess. He'll say the court's taking a recess, and he'll put him, he'll take him last. Even if his case was about to take place then, he'll move him to the last at the end of the day where no one else can see what he's doing. Because he don't want people exposed to the information. They do. Right? Is that true?
When I had my case with the chief judge, that's what the chief did. He made sure I was the last one.
See that?
They accidentally called me in the middle where everybody was there. The chief was like, no. You know what I'm saying? He made sure they set me back down.
Yeah, you see that?
That's so good.
Because they don't want the mass mind to wake up.
Yeah,
because someone else is going, what the hell is going on? What is this guy doing?
I knew a CIA agent that when he would go to court, he would talk to the judge in the private room and be like, yo, this is not foul. And
judges team.
Yeah.
Did you see that short video on YouTube? I think it was a Moore, and he shut that judge down. It was the white judge or whatever, and he just started saying everything. She couldn't say nothing. He kept cutting her off.
Oh yeah. I know yourself. But you really don't want to present yourself that way. You see what I'm saying? Yeah.
He wasn't in his proper status anyway.
Yeah.
She was trying to help him out. She was telling him that he had a proper thing with that court, but he didn't probably understand what she was saying.
Yeah. Yeah, a lot of them are real skeptical of him, man. Go ahead.
Uniform Commercial Code via public notice, which is the code that the fictional commercial world operates under. The UCC-1 financing statement, security interest in a lien, and the filing of the existence of these documents will redeem you and your straw man debtor from the commercial system and establish documented evidence to overcome the presumption that you are the surety for the straw man. When all has been accepted for value, including your birth certificate, you become the holder in due course of all the documents, collateral, and the property, and are now in commercial control of the property, the collateral, and the debtor. 15 U.S.C. 1127, the definitions include commercial name, name, juristic name, etc. In this section, you'll find that a government officer or employee functions in a commercial capacity. Read 26 U.S. Code 6331, levy and distraint. Strawman is a transmitting utility. Is a strawman the mere artificial commercial entity employee instrument by which the parent corporation, U.S. federal government, directs and extracts all fines, fees, and taxes from? Is the straw man an employee or officer of the United States? If it is a trust regulated and held by the United States, well then, absolutely. The straw man being the transmitting utility.
So it's a trust held by the United States until you become a creditor and take charge of that, until you control that instrument. Okay?
The straw man being the transmitting utility within the commercial scheme venue world that is the entity.
So you can't operate in commerce without the straw man, without controlling that. Right.
Then would it not be too far-fetched to understand that since the government cannot produce a federal law or statute that specifically proves that a flesh and blood man or woman is subject and liable to the tax, they are not. They not being federal employees, being that the tax is only applied to the straw man.
If you do the 1040 form, you're voluntarily saying that you're a federal employee. 1040 form is only for federal employees. Okay?
And you now may in control of the straw man and in the secured party creditor status that you now have, the ability to change your standing, thus limiting or eliminating such a burden. In legis, a definition is a creature of the law, an actual being as contrasted with a natural person, applied to corporations, considered as deriving their existence entirely from the law. Transmitting utility definition means a person primarily engaged in the business of A, operating a railroad, subway, street, railway, or trolley bus, B, transmitting electric or electronic communications, C, transmitting goods by pipeline or sewer, D, transmitting or producing or transmitting electricity, steam, gas, or water. The debtor straw man is actually a commercial transmitting utility. It, your debtor, is a utility that all commercial transaction charges pass through and is your duty, family, and responsibility to accept for value and discharge all the charges, claims, fines, debts, taxes, etc. You can now choose to learn to become a creditor, or fall back to sleep during the seminar and remain in the matrix as a debtor. New class of citizens. The 14th Amendment provided for a new class of citizens. United States citizen that has not been formally recognized. Prior to the 14th Amendment in 1868, there were no persons born or naturalized in the United States. All citizens.
So you got that? Born? Prior to 1868, there was no such thing as a person born and naturalized in the United States. They was born in what? Each individual state. The United States that they're talking about here is Washington, D.C.
We're just Americans.
Go ahead.
All citizens have been born or naturalized in the several states. This new class of citizens were given
So that
privilege.
State in which you was born was your country. Right?
This new class of citizens was given privilege to
you,
go.
So you was given privileges. Hey, you want some welfare? Become a citizen. Want food stamps? Become a citizen. Hey, you want your children to go to public school? Become a citizen. Because a public school is a benefit. Right?
In democracy, in 1870, by the 15th Amendment, these new citizen subjects were required to apply for marriage, register to vote, register births, deaths, etc.
So, does a living soul have to do this? Does a man have to do this? No. But citizens have to do this. They gotta apply for marriages, they gotta register to vote. But a man doesn't have to do this. I'm just an agreed man. Okay?
All is required was an application. Benefits came with this new citizenship, but with the benefits came duties and responsibilities and liabilities that were totally regulated by the legislature for the District of Columbia. We talked about Edward Mandel House yesterday, and he attributed with giving a very detailed outline of his plans to be implemented to enslave the American people. The 13th Amendment in 1865 opened the way for people to volunteer into slavery to accept the benefits offered by the United States. Central banking for the United States was legislated in Federal Reserve Act 1913. The ability to decrease the currency in circulation through taxation was legislated with the 16th Amendment in 1913. Support for the presumption that the
Initially, where was the Mickey Mouse tax brought along? Where was the federal tax brought along? Initially, the income tax was supposed to be a temporary thing. Okay?
Support for the presumption that the American people has volunteered to participate in United States democracy was legislated with the 17th Amendment in 1913. The path was provided for the control of the courts by the British Crowns with the creation of the American Bar Association in 1913.
That's all lawyers.
In 1917, the United States Legislature passed the Trading with the Enemy Act and the Emergency War Powers Act, opening the doors for the United States to suspend limitation otherwise.
This is why America never declares war anymore when she goes to war, because she's been under the Emergency War Powers since then. They never declare a war when they invade people anymore.
In the 1920s, the states accelerated the push for mothers to register their babies as first required upon the new federal property, the so-called free black slaves. In the 1930s, federal legislation provided for registration of babies through applications for birth certificates, so government workers could get maternity leave with pay. The states pushed for registration, surrender of ownership of cars through application for certificates of title, and for registration of land through registration of deeds of trust, which turned the land over to the state. Constructive trust was secretly created as each of the people blindly walked into the United States democracy, thereby agreeing to be sureties for the debts of the United States. The Great Depression supplied a diversion to keep the people's attention off what the government was doing. The Social Security program was implemented along with numerous other United States programs that invited the American people to volunteer to be volunteer sureties behind the U.S. new registered property and adhesion contracts to the new U.S. United States subjects. The plan was well on its way by 1933. Massive registration, aka surrender, of property through the United States agencies, including the state subdivisions, was assuring that the United States and its officers would get rich beyond their wildest expectations. All of this was done without full disclosure of the material facts that accompany each application for registrations. The United States only needed to provide the remedy. It was not required to explain it or even tell the people where the remedy could be found. The attorneys did not even have to be taught about the remedy. That gave them plausible deniability.
Remember that means they could deny it even exists.
When the people struggled to understand the new laws, if the people failed to use their remedy, the United States came out the winner every time. If the people did discover the remedy, the United States had to honor it and release the registered property back to the people, but only if the people knew they had a remedy, and only if they requested it in the proper manner. This was a great plan. How can the American people be free and subject to a de facto government whims at the same time? In 1933, the United States put its insurance policy into place with the House Joint Resolution 192.
Hey James, can you come and open the door?
And recorded it in the Congressional Record. It was not required to be promulgated in the Federal Register. An executive order issued on April 5th, 1933, paved the way for the withdrawal of the gold in the U.S. HJR 192 was an insurance policy that protected and guaranteed the legislators an out from conviction for fraud and treason against the American people. HJR 192 provided that the one with the coal paid the bills. It removed the requirements that the United States subjects and employees had to pay their debts with gold. It actually prohibited the inclusion of a clause in all subsequent contracts would require payment in gold. It also canceled the clause in every contract written prior to June 5th, 1933, that required an obligation to be paid in gold retroactively. It provided the United States subjects and employees could use any type of gold, coin, and currency to discharge a public debt as long as it was in use to the normal course of business in the United States. For a time, United States notes were the currency used to discharge debt, but later the Federal Reserve and the United States provided a new medium of exchange through paper notes, funny money, and debt instruments that could be passed on into the debtors, creditors to discharge the debtor's debts. That same currency, the Federal Reserve notes, is used to discharge public debts. But take note, the Federal Reserve notes have no value and is stated by the Federal Reserve. So we have the history of the UCC introduced in 1950. In the 1950s, the Uniform Commercial Code was presented in their states as a means of unifying the generally accepted procedures for handling the new legal system of dealing with commercial transactions and fictions as though they were real. The security instruments, aka the commercial paper, replaced substance as collateral for debts. Security instruments could be supported by presumptive contracts, money of exchange, and the need for money as disappearing, the new money was being created, aka, for example, money of account, created by bill of exchange, and a uniform system of law had to be put in place to allow the commercial venue in the course to uphold the security instruments that depended on commercial fictions as a basis for compelling payment of performance. Check out tender payment in your state statute.
Yeah, we went over that yesterday, tender payment, UCC-3603B. I might have been to say,
All this was accomplished by the mid-1960s, and by 1964, most all states had adopted the Uniform Commercial Code. The Commercial Code is merely a codification of accepted and required procedures all people engaged in commercial activities must follow. Those who entice the people to register, aka surrender, their property, land, guns, cars, children, etc., to the subdivisions, states, under dictate by the United States, gained control of the substance through the registrations, and the states were able to extract more use taxes from the people to use the property of the state. The states and United States became the holder of the titles to all the property, even children and other and many other things. The definition of property is the interest one has in a thing. The thing is the principle, the property is the interest in the thing. You are responsible for knowing the law. The owner is responsible for learning the law, so he understands that the profits from his things are available for him to discharge debts or charges brought against his public person or the debtor struck man by the U.S. Fund definition is money set aside to pay a debt. Debtors may have the use of certain things, but the things belong to the creditors. The creditor is the master, the debtor is a servant. The Uniform Commercial Code is very specific about the duties and responsibility a debtor has. If the owner of the thing is presumed to be a debtor because of his previous admissions and adhesion contracts, he's going to have a difficult time convincing the United States that he has a duty to discharge public debts for him. In addition, the courts are staffed with royal loyal judges who will look for every mistake that people may make when trying to use their remedy. Now the quasi-owner, aka the user of the property, the thing, after looking the land and discovering who he is in relationship to the United States Corporation, can file a UCC financing statement based upon a security agreement, registering his security interest in the artificial entity, debtor, or person, being the in legis, which the United States created after your mom signed over the root of title, the newborn identification, and then was compelled to apply for a birth certificate. This was the act of registering for biological property, her baby, which was a substance, within the state of wherever, The United States hold a paper title, which is the form, not the substance, which we the baby. Until your financing statement is filed, the United States is the holder of the title to the artificial entity. It is the name, its name is spelled in the all capital letters name, for example, John Henry Doe. When John Henry Doe files a financing statement supported by the security agreement signed by the artificial entity, the capital John, and the owner John, the lowercase John, he becomes the holder in due course of the title to the uppercase John. The UCC, the state commercial law, are very specific about the effect of a registered security interest. It has priority over other interests claimed, only claimed, in the same thing. The evidence that is missing in the court is the registered claim over the person, the uppercase John. When you, as the owner of a thing, registered it with the United States or one of its subdivisions, you let the United States hold the legal title to your thing based on misrepresentation and failure to disclose material facts to you at the time of registration. You probably retained possession of the thing, but the United States invested the title and made a profit. This is their insurance policy to assure that they are not convicted of treason. That does not mean they cannot be charged with treason, but the courts will dismiss based on failure to state a claim upon which relief can be granted. Because you have a remedy outside the court, you cannot sustain a charge of treason. Why do you pay taxes? Today, the majority of Americans pay taxes because when they get a job, their employer requests they fill out either an IRS form, W-2, the W-4, or form 1099, which as a direct result withholds taxes from their paychecks for their labor. The majority doesn't have a clue as to why they're paying these taxes in the first place, other than they're being conditioned to pay their so-called fair share. It has been affirmed that labor is a fundamental, unalienable, protected right, and this fundamental right is not supposed to be taxed. No profit or gain is to be realized via your labor. No knowledge. The Bible unquestionably verifies this with the following. The book of Isaiah, 5th chapter, 13th verse, tells us, "Therefore my people are gone into captivity because they have no knowledge." In the book of Hosea, 4th chapter, 6th verse, "My people are destroyed for a lack of knowledge." Out of necessity to operate the government, President Lincoln issued Executive Order No. 2 in April 1861, reconvening the Congress at gunpoint in the Executive Emergency Martial Law Rule Jurisdiction. Since that time, there has been no de jure, which is sanctioned by law, Congress. Everything functions under color of law, which is the appearance or resemblance without substance of legal right. Through executive orders under authority of the war powers, for example, the emergency law of necessity.
So we're going to have to stop right there, because it's like 5:40. We're going to have to stop right there and start putting things down. So we've got 100 slides left.
Roger that. Tazadaq that.
We've got like 100 slides left. Because all of the questions. But yeah, we're going to stop right here.
Is there any way to include those slides on the DVD?
No, they are on the other DVD. Like I got through all of this, like in Atlanta. Yeah. And Atlanta was only 12 hours versus this one being like 16. This was 4 hours. All of the questions.
4 hours.
All of the questions interrupting.
Plus, we covered some different things here. With,
yeah, we covered some different things.
Getting the passport.
No. There's a couple different things. You're going to vote on that card. I kept that card up there. So can we get a group photo or something? Can you grab that camera and take a group photo?
Sure. Group photo, don't be shy.